next session is titled Sports and Fractals. Costas Pelechrinis is an associate professor in the School of Computing and Information at the University of Pittsburgh, and his research involves developing analytical methods and metrics for multidimensional data, utilizing linear algebra and statistical techniques. He is a recipient of the prestigious Young Investigator Award from the Army Research Office.
Thanks for coming to my talk, where we'll talk about sports and fractals, and you might be wondering about sports. This is a conference about sports, but what fractals have to do with sports, right? So it's sort of a physics conference. In order to see a little bit why these two notions might be relevant, let's see a little bit the definition that you get if you look what a fractal is, right? And I have pointed out there that fractals are useful for modeling structures where similar patterns occur over and over again and describe some partially random or chaotic phenomena, right? So if you think about it, sports, you can think of it as a structure. Things happen repeatedly. Players pass the ball, they take shots, they run. Some events are random, other skills, but you have randomness as well. So why not use fractals to try and describe some of the aspects of sports? So that was the main idea. Now, I won't bore you a lot with theory behind fractals, but I will give the high-level ideas and the ones that we need to know in order to understand the intuition behind it. So fractals, the main properties that they have, self-similar. So a system is called self-similar if it has the same patterns, statistical patterns over different scales, and we will explain what scales means. Now, many times self-similarity is referred to as scale invariance, even though they are not the same thing. So scale invariance is an extreme version of self-similarity. But the interesting thing is that fractals, even though they were developed mainly by complex system theory and theory of chaos and all this stuff, they have been used to explain and model many, a wide variety of phenomena and systems. So for example, this famous paper at the PNAS, early 90s, where basically they identified that the classical music from Bach and Beethoven, it follows a fractal pattern. Right? And then they have generated this automated systems for generating music, trying to emulate, simulate the way fractals behave. Now, people who have worked in networks, they know most probably that a lot of properties of statistical properties of network can be described by power laws, which typically describe a fractal behavior, right? And now one other interesting thing, and something that will be very relevant to what we will discuss here about sports, is the coastline paradox. So before explaining the coastline paradox, let's just see how one might be going about measuring a curve, right? So you have a curve, a smooth curve, and you want to try to measure its length, right? From calculus one, you might remember that basically what you're doing is that you're taking small linear pieces, you try to approximate the curve with the linear piece, and then you essentially measure, you know the shortest path on the line, and you measure that. As you keep making this line smaller and smaller, then your measurement will converge, right? And this is the whole notion of calculus, that as you get smaller, the smaller and smaller scales, your measurements will converge. So the coastline paradox says that if you try to do this with coastlines, this will not be the case. So if you change the scale that you measure, so essentially if you change this side, this linear segment that you try to measure the coastline, it will be different, it will not converge. So small changes in this line segment will create basically a different end result. There is no convergence. So this is exactly the fractal geometry and what fractal is. So why sports though? So the la- describe the relationships between the distance of the points that you have to analyze and how the cumulative distribution of this. Essentially, it's a way to describe the dimensionality of an object, right? In typical Euclidean geometry, you have either single-dimensional objects, two-dimensional objects, three-dimensional objects, so in the integer dimensions. Fractal dimensionality can describe objects in more detail and give you things like real values for dimensionality, so it doesn't necessarily be integer. Okay, so here are some examples in order to give you a better intuition of what fractal dimensionality will give you. In the last example, which most probably it's the easiest to explain, basically you have a set of points that are randomly thrown into a rectangle, right? So essentially, if you try and calculate the fractal dimensionality of this set of points, it will be close to 2, right? Which is equal to the topological dimensionality, which is the points essentially fill up the whole space. Now, if you start giving them a specific pattern, like for example in the first one, you will see that the points fall on a line, but they don't fill up the line, right? So the dimensionality is much smaller because essentially you need less information in order to describe the structure. And then the second, the figure in the middle, it's much more complex than the first set point, right? So it has a higher dimensionality, but it's not quite as complex as the random case. So the dimensionality is about 1.6. So this gives you that basically the different values of dimensionality have some different represent intuitively how the points are basically distributed on the plane. So there are many ways. Actually, there are many ways to count to measure this fractal dimensionality. The most popular one is what is called box counting. So essentially, you can think that you have a set of points, which are here the black dots, and then you overlay a grid over these points, right? And this grid has square cells that say you change their size. So, for example, in the first case, let's say that you have the squares having one unit of length, and you see that, for example, there are 8 squares where a point is in. Right? Then in the second case, you increase this grid size, and you see that there are only 7 squares that have at least one point in them. Then you go to 4, and you see that there are only 5. So essentially, then what you do is that you create the relationship between delta and n, and the slope of this will give you the fractal dimensionality. That's the easiest way to calculate. Now, fractal dimensionality, if I didn't convince you that I can help model stuff in sports, maybe this paper that was presented, that was published at the Journal of Chaos and Fractals, maybe will convince you. So this paper, what they did is that they used the fractal dimensionality notion in order to classify dances, different Latin dances. So for example here, you have a typical pattern for a salsa dance, and a typical pattern for a merengue dance, and basically the authors of this paper, they classified the fractal dimensionality of every dance, right? So the question is how basically you can use that for sports, right? And why am I talking about fractals? The thing is that all major sports, they have some spatial notion, right? So in soccer, you have people, you have 11 players on each team running the field, having spatial trajectories, passing the ball, which is itself a spatial trajectory. Then you have at American football, you have basically routes run from the players, the ball also follows its own trajectory. Basketball is the same thing, hockey is the same thing. So you have basically a lot of spatial information on how people are distributed on the field, with distribution, the spatial distribution of point, of locations where you take your shots, and so on. Right? So there is a huge possibility that we're using notions for fractal dimensionality in sport. So one thing that I first wanted to do is basically see whether you can use the fractal dimensionality in order to recover some of the things that we know from typical classical data analysis, right? And the idea behind this is that basically some sort of a validation that fractal dimensionality is indeed something that can give good results. So what I did basically is I analyzed the three-point shots and the floor utilization dimensionality, as I mentioned. So everyone here knows that you know, we are in a series of three-point shots in the last years. But it's interesting is if you see where the three-point shots are taken from, I mean, you see that the density of the distance of the shots from the basket, you will see that just inside the three-point line, there is a dip, as you expect, right? So basically, players, what they are doing is they are they prefer to take the shot just outside the three-point line as compared to just inside the three-point line, which is a rational behavior, right? It's, it gives you a higher effective field goal. And why is this rational? It's rational because if you take actually the field goal percentage for the shots taken just 1 foot inside the three-point line and just 1 foot outside the three-point line at both corners and at the crest, there is no statistical difference at the field goal percentages. And actually, if you plot some of these shots, you will see that clearly there is a space inside the three-point line which is not utilized for shots, right? But we knew that. So the question is whether you can use fractal dimensionality in order to recover this and see that fractal dimensionality did helps here. So what I did is I took all the shots that happened around the three-point line, 1 foot outside and 1 foot inside the three-point line. And basically I computed the fractal dimensionality that you get from these points, which I present in the second column. And then what I call the theoretical fractal dimensionality is what is the dimensionality that you would expect if players were randomly making the shots, right? So if they did not have any intuition on whether they were inside or outside the three-point line, they would take the shots uniformly at random from this small area, right? About 1 foot in and 1 foot out. And you see that there is a big difference, right? So the actual dimensionality is much smaller, as you would expect, than the one that you would expect if players were not biased towards taking the three-point shots rather than the two-point shots. So as we said, we knew that already, but what this shows is that basically fractal dimensionality can actually give you a different point of view for some things. So one way to use fractal dimensionality is to define what I term fractal versatility index. Right? So the objective is how to quantify the spatial distribution of the player's shots, right? How, where does this player attack from, right? Is it, can he spread the floor? Is he a single-dimensional player? Right? That's truly about dimension, right? So this is a proxy for offensive versatility. And here, for example, I have the shot chart of Jan Zanetokubo. People from around here probably know him, and this is from his second, from his sophomore campaign in the NBA, where still he doesn't have really a three-point shot, but you see here that most of his shots were really around the rim, and you see that the fractal dimensionality is fairly small, right? It's 0.72, which means that it's a little less than single dimension, right? So here are some examples of fractal dimensionality of different players. So, for example, you see that James Harden has 1.4, pretty high. The same is for Steph Curry. Leonard and LeBron James have around 1. As you expect, DeAndre Jordan and Capella have much less. They are basically attacking to the ring. And then I have two players here with fractal dimensionalities that are fairly large, right? 1.27 and 1.44. And make a guess which players are this based on the other results. So you would expect, since they have high, basically, fractal dimensionality, that there are people that are somewhere between Steph Curry and Leonard or LeBron, but it turns out that this is Pau Gasol and this is Tim Duncan. So these are, again, from 2 years back. So the question is, okay, it seemed that you had a pattern, right? It seemed that centers had low fractal dimensionality, point guards had higher fractal dimensionality. What's going on here? So the key point is that, going a little bit on the theory of us is that this self-similarity doesn't hold over all scales. Right? It holds under specific scales. So what we have to do here is to calculate what we call radius of gyration. Right? So it can be the case that, for example, Tim Duggan and Pau Gasol have high fractal dimensionality, but they don't use all the space. They don't really use a lot of the space outside 3 points. But wherever they sort from, they utilize the whole area, right? So that's why they have higher dimensionality. So that's why we calculate what is called radius of gyration, which basically is a proxy for the scale, right? So how far apart are the points that the players take shots from, right? You can think of it as a spatial variation, right? So, for example, James Harden and Steph Curry have high variation, right? Because they take shots from many different distances. Whereas, for example, Tim Duncan and other centers are very much smaller, right? So by using this second variable, which is the scale, essentially, you can differentiate between centers and point guards that both have high fractal dimensionality, but they have significantly different range. So you can use these two parameters, the fractal dimensionality and the scale, basically to try and see whether you can cluster players. So, for example, this cluster of players includes players like Kerry and Harden. Obviously, this one has mainly centers where they all have low fractal dimensionality. They vary in their range. And there are other clusters that they overlap and, of course, can include a mix of players. So that's one way that possibly fractal dimensionality can be used by developing a matrix to basically quantify shot behavior, shot profiles of players. But there is another interesting parameter in basically in the spatial tracking data, right? And in particular, in for basketball, and in the same hackathon with Melanie, what I try to do is basically to see if you can use fractal dimensionality to quantify ball movement, right? How you can say that a specific attack had a good ball movement compared to another one. The problem is here, how do you evaluate, right? Ideally, you would like someone to annotate the data and say that this was a really good ball movement, this was not. So what we did is, what I did is that I did the indirect evaluation. So the idea is that if you have a good ball movement, then it's most probably that you would score, right? Even though that, again, might not be necessarily true. And even better would be to say that you at least got a very good shot, right? A wide open shot. So I calculate the fractal dimensionality of the ball trajectory, right? So how the ball was distributed across the half court during the attack. And I just did a very simple, I looked for a very simple relationship between the success or not of the attack, whether it was a made field goal or not, and there was a significant correlation at the 10% level, but we only had 5 games, so it might be an issue of power, or it might be that there's no power. But in general, what we found is that attacks that have lower fractal dimensionality, they actually tend to have to be more successful. And here are 2 examples. You have 1 example with where you have a low fractal dimensionality and it was a made field goal. And you have another one with significantly different fractal dimensionality and it was a missed field goal. Of course, this is a handpicked to make a great different visualization, but overall, there seems to be a pattern. That can be further examined. Now, I also use the same type of ideas for soccer. So in soccer, you also have shot charts, right? So you know where players took their shots from. You know which ones resulted in a goal or not. So first, we defined an expected models, an expected goal model. Typical way to do that is basically take variables like where the shot was taken from, what is the distance, whether it was an open set play, and so on. And you build a model basically that gives you the probability that this shot would result in a goal, right? So what we did then is that we defined team efficiency, offensive and defensive, based on how then what we did is that we calculated the short, from the short charge of everything, the fractal dimensionality. And what we found is that if you take the pins that have fractal dimensionality above the median, they had an average of 6.7% efficiency, which means they scored 6.7% more than what you would expect them from the shots they take. Whereas if you take the half, the top, the bottom 50th percentile, below the median, you had a -9% offensive efficiency. So, for example, here are two examples from Orlando, Toronto. For example, Orlando takes shots in a much more constrained area, right? In an area where they are high percentage shots, and this gives them a high efficiency and also a lower dimensionality. Whereas Toronto spreads their offense and their shots; they take shots from very far distances compared to other teams, and they have lower efficiency, at least in the data set. So the question is, what can you do with that, right? So there are many possibilities. This is just scraping the surface, right? Sport view data. You can analyze not just the trajectory of the ball, but the trajectory of the player, right? How do they move off the ball? Do they move across the whole court? Pitch effect data, which I have never used, but it seems that you can analyze the pitchers. The pitch is basically to see what's the fractal dimensionality of the pitcher and whether we can learn anything that we don't know from that. Of course, next gen NFL stats, where you have all the trajectories of the players, you can see which routes are successful, which routes end up in big plays, and if there's any relationships with the complexity of the route, which can be captured for fractal dimensionality. So there is really a large spectrum of different sport that you can use this notion to analyze. And of course, hockey, which is very similar to soccer. So some resources. I know Perl is a very old language, but there is some good code about the fractal dimensionality. Of course, there is an R package for fractal dimensionality and a package at MATLAB if you want to do an experiment. And if you have any questions,
similarities?
So the fractal dimensionality, essentially, what it is, let me...
Well, perhaps a better way to answer the same question. What's the difference between Hausdorff dimension and fractal?
It's Hausdorff dimension is one type of fractal dimension.
Okay.
So there are many different types of fractal dimension. So in my case, what I used is the definition, which is very similar to Hausdorff dimension, but it's not exactly the same. But there are many different. So, for example, there's a fractal dimensionality for time series, which is different.
Right.
So, there are many different dimensions.
Oh, sorry, I have a question. Is there. So all of the examples that you displayed so far were all fractal dimensionality with a theoretical maximum of 2.
Yes.
Is there any possibility of getting anything interesting out of third possible dimension, attacking with height in soccer or even basketball?
It could be. Actually, sport view data have a third dimension for the ball. It's dribbled or not. But I think for soccer it might make more sense actually, because there are a lot of parts. So, for example, there's the English version of soccer where you play with long passes from the air, and the Spanish one that you play on the ground. So, I think that you can definitely use more dimensions to define this type of sport.
Any other questions?
Dr.
relevant to your specific talk here, but I'm sure the Army's not interested in Steph Curry's dimensions. And if you can, at some general level, can you speak to the use of fractals?
So the way I started with the fractal dimensionality was basically completely different from sports. So one was to identify when the driver looks for parking, because the curve of the driving is changing when you're looking for parking than when you're going to destination. And then also it's used a lot in networks, right? And there are many interesting patterns on that go beyond the single the direct connections that you can analyze with fractal dimensionality. So with this distance that we are talking about,